Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I want to thank each of you for joining with me for Saturday's Daily Bible Study, coming from Charlene's Outreach Ministries. Our lesson for today, His yoke is easy. His yoke is easy, coming from Matthew 11, verses 25 through 30. We have a wonderful and powerful lesson, but before we get started, I want to ask each of you, if something they say touches your heart, soul, or spirit, or you have any questions or comments, please feel free to jot them at the bottom below. Or if you would like prayer, please let me know and I will add you to the prayer list as well. Also, if you would, join with us as we gather together as a church body of Christ, studying and meditating on the word of the Lord as we go forward in doing His will and walking in His true light. Amen. We're going to get ready and get started. But before we get started, we're going to have prayer. Then we're going to move right into the lesson. Amen. Dear God in heaven, we thank you, Father. We thank you for all the many blessings that you bestow upon us, those seen and unseen. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for waking us up this morning and starting us on our day. We thank you, Father, for going with us and taking care of us, Father. We thank you for being with us up and down the dangerous highway day and night in our name, Father. We give you the glory, honor, and the praise, Father. Lord, we thank you because you are wonderful and that you are our counselor and that you are God Almighty. And beside you, there is none other in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you that you are everlasting Father and our Prince of Peace. We thank you for all the many blessings that you bestowed upon us, those seen and unseen, Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Father, for making a way out of no way in the name of Jesus. Lord, we come to you today thanking you for your great grace and mercy that you bestow upon us, that we open our eyes and we do see, and our ears and we do hear, and we gain wisdom, knowledge, and understanding from your word as we study and meditate on your word in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you, Heavenly Father, that as the Holy Spirit works in each and every one of us, Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise, knowing that the Holy Spirit will unction us and give us each personally what we need from each and every lesson. And we thank you for it, Father, because you know the hairs of our head, each and every one of us, one by one and name by name, Father. As you know the name of the stars in the sky, Father, we know that you are our all in all and that you are our blessing and our take care of us in the name of Jesus. Lord, we give you honor, glory, and praise, and we thank you for it, Father. We thank you for your wisdom, knowledge, and understanding from on high. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. We're going to get ready and get started. His yoke is easy. His yoke is easy. Amen. And as we say, our lesson is coming from Matthew 25 through 30. But because usually the New Testament lessons have a more expounded commentary on the lesson, and it has a great deal of understanding in it, that I try to add it in it so it makes it a little lengthy, but it is very good for the body, for the mind, for understanding, open up questions that many of us had throughout the time we've studied these passages over the years. Amen. We're going to get ready and get started. Verses 25 through 27, we're going to read the first half. And it says, at that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and prudent and have revealed them to babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight. All things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Amen, amen. This is a great and powerful passage here, letting us know that as Jesus Christ is in the Father and the Father is in him, so as we get a grasp and understanding of this, that lets us know if Jesus Christ is in us, then the Father is also in us. Amen. We're speaking about the Savior's reaction to rejection. He's being rejected here, yet he's saying who he is and whose he is. We have to realize that we must realize whose we are, who we belong to, and know, and even in our rejection, even in our troubles, even in our trials, that we are to bring to mind who we belong to. Amen. Commentary says, the three cities of Galilee had neither eyes to see nor heart to love the Christ of God. He knew their attitude was but a foretaste, a rejection on a wider scale. How did he react to their impotence? Not with bitterness, cynicism, or vindictiveness. Rather, he lifted his voice in thanks to God that nothing could frustrate his sovereign purpose. I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and prudent and have revealed them to babes. We should avoid two possible misunderstandings. First, Jesus was not expressing pleasure in the inevitable judgment of the Galilean cities. Secondly, he did not imply that God had high-handedly withheld the light from the wise and the prudent. The cities had every chance to welcome the Lord Jesus. They deliberately refused to submit to him. When they refused the light, God withheld the light from them. But God's plans will not fail if the intelligent will not believe. Then God will reveal him to humble hearts. He fills the hungry with good things and sends the rich away empty. Luke 1:53. Amen. And this gives us more as we think about it, that the fact that many times people that are very learned are the main ones that, and I hate to say this in this manner, but can be the ones that will fall away quicker because they have so much intelligence that they overread into things and they are not willing to give over full dependence in the written word of the Lord. They got to interpret it and overthink it and because they don't understand an area at this time in their life, they want to take it aside or say that the word is not true, and this is not what we are to do. It will be things that we don't understand in the word. It will be things that we feel that may not align up. But as we grow in the word, then we then see how the word does line up. It's just that our eyes is not open to that point at that time. And so we cannot allow Satan to get into us as because we are well learned and well versed and understanding and all this kind of stuff, to allow Satan to pull us away from the love of sin. Because you see here, this don't match this over here. Just wait on the Lord and he'll show you. He'll show you where it matches. Just give him, just turn it over to him. Amen. It said those who consider themselves too wise and understanding to need Christ become afflicted with judicial blindness, but those who admit their lack of wisdom receive a revelation of him in whom are hidden all the treasures of the wisdom and knowledge. Colossians 2:3. Jesus thanked the Father for ordaining that if some would not have him, others would. In the face of titanic unbelief, he found consolation in the overruling plan of and purpose of God. All things had been delivered to Christ by his Father. This would be a presumptuous claim for anyone else, but from the Lord Jesus, it is a simple statement of truth. At that moment, with opposition mounting, it did not appear that he was in control. Nonetheless, it was true. The program of his life was moving irresistibly toward eventual glorious triumph. No one knows the Son except the Father. There is an incomprehensible mystery about the person of Christ, the union of deity, humanity in one person raises problems that boggle the human mind. For instance, there is the problem of death. God cannot die, yet Jesus is God, and Jesus died, and yet his divine and human natures are inseparable. So although we can know him and love him and trust him, there is a sense in which only the Father can truly understand. There is a sense in which only the Father can truly understand him. It says, but the high mysteries of thy name, the creature's grasp transcends. The Father only, glorious claim, the Son can comprehend. Worthy, O Lamb of God, art thou, that every knee to thee should bow. Amen. That comes from Josiah Condor. It said, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and he whom the Son wills to reveal him. The Father, too, is instructable ultimately. Only God is great enough to understand God. Man cannot know him by his own strength or intellect, but the Lord Jesus can and does reveal the Father to those whom he chooses. Whoever comes to know the Son comes to know the Father. Also, John 14:7, although the nation of Israel is moving toward the ordeal of divine judgment, the King in his final word throws open wide the door of personal salvation, and thus he proves that he is a God of grace, even on the threshold of judgment. Verses 28 through 30 says, come to me, all ye who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen. As we follow Christ, as we follow him, then we are to know, then we learn how to walk out the Christian life, how to walk out the saved salvation life that we have received. It said, come to means to believe, to in Acts 16:31, and to receive, John 1:12, to eat in John 6:35, to drink, John 7:37, to look, Isaiah 45:22, to confess, 1 John 4:2, to hear, John 5:24-25, to enter a door, John 10:9, to open a door, Revelation 3:20, and to touch the hem of his garment, Matthew 9:20-21, and to accept the gift of eternal life through Christ our Lord, Romans 6:23. To me, the object of faith is not a church, a creed, or a clergyman, but the living Christ. Salvation is in a person, Jesus Christ. Those who have Jesus are as saved as God can make them. All you who labor are heavy laden. In order to truly come to Jesus, a person must admit that he is burdened with the weight of sin. Only those who acknowledge they are lost can be saved. Faith in the Lord Jesus is preceded by repentance toward God. And I will give you rest. Notice that rest here is a gift. It is unearned and unmerited. This is the rest of salvation that comes from revealing that Christ finished the work of redemption on Calvary's cross. It is the rest of conscience that follows the realization that the penalty of one's sin has been paid once for all, and that God will not demand payment twice. In verse 29 and 30, the invitation changes from salvation to service, to turn over control of one's life to him. In Romans 12:1-2, and learn from me, as we acknowledge his lordship in every area of our life, he trains us in his ways, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. In contrast to the Pharisees who were harsh and proud, the true teacher is meek and lowly. Those who take his yoke will learn to take the lowest place, and you will find rest for your souls. Here it is, not the rest of conscience, but the rest of the heart that is found by taking the lowest place before God and man. It is also the rest that one experiences in the service of Christ when he stops trying to be great. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Again, there is a striking contrast with the Pharisees. Jesus said of them, For thou bind heavy burdens hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves would not move them with one of their fingers. Matthew 23:4. Jesus' yoke is easy. It does not chafe. Someone has suggested that if Jesus had had a sign outside his carpenter shop, it would have read, "My yoke fits well." His burden is light. This does not mean that there are no problems, trials, labor, or heartaches in the Christian life, but it does mean that we do not have to bear them alone. We are yoked with one who gives sufficient grace for every time of need. To serve him is not bondage, but perfect freedom. John H. Howard says, "The fatal mistake for the believer is to seek to bear life's load in a single collar. God never intended a man to carry his burden alone. Christ therefore deals only in yokes. A yoke is a neck harness for two, and the Lord himself pleads to be one of the two. He wants to share the labor of any galling task. The secret of peace and victory in the Christian life is found in putting off the taxing collar of self and accepting the master's relaxing yoke." Amen, amen. That is so powerful and wonderful that I truly wanted you to hear that, that the yoke that we put on of Christ is made for two, and he's the second one with us. That's a powerful and wonderful lesson. As we look at this lesson, do not forget to add what it means in getting to know Jesus in this lesson. What does it mean in getting to know Jesus in the lesson of his yoke is easy? Amen, amen. Y'all have a wonderful and blessed day. God bless you.